Harper One and Harper Audio present The Bible, With and Without Jesus, How Jews and Christians Read the Same Stories Differently, by Amy Jill Levine and Marc V. Brettler, read by Marni Penning. A note before we begin. Don't forget to download the accompanying enhancement PDF from your audiobook provider, or go directly to www.harpercollins.com/audio/Bible with and without Jesus. The enhancement contains notes on translations and abbreviations found in this book. Preface. Our book's cover, Marc Chagall's Abraham and the Three Angels, 1966, offers readers the choice of multiple interpretations. Some may see an invocation of Genesis 18, the story of three angels or messengers who appear to Abraham and Sarah and announce that Sarah, well into menopause, will soon, miraculously, give birth to a son. For these readers, the picture may bring to mind a main theme of the Bible, expressed through the text's powerful question, "Is anything too wonderful for the Lord?" Genesis 18:14. Those aware of Jewish biblical interpretation may be reminded of the tradition of Abraham as the model of hospitality, who every day sat at the entrance of his tent in the heat of the day, Genesis 18:1, to greet any passers-by and to give them water and food to refresh themselves before they continued on their journey. Christian readers might focus on the meal as representing the Eucharist, or on the angel's halos, a typical depiction in Christian art, and view this painting as recalling earlier Christian depictions of this scene, where the halos indicate that these three angelic visitors are the Holy Trinity. To complicate matters more, what does it mean that the Jewish Chagall painted this scene from the Hebrew Bible, using images that characterize Eastern Orthodox icons, in particular Andrei Rublev's The Old Testament Trinity? We suggest that all of these perspectives, the biblical, the Jewish, the Christian, are important, and all are necessarily partial. The answers we receive, the interpretations we develop, are all dependent on the questions we ask, the experiences we bring, and the preferences we have. The multiple interpretations of Chagall's picture highlight the intent of this book. Its title is not The Bible With or Without Jesus, it is The Bible With and Without Jesus. This title offers three subjects that we care about equally: Bible, with Jesus, and without Jesus. We do not claim that only one way of reading Genesis, or any other text in what is called variously the Hebrew Bible, the Tanakh, and the Old Testament, is correct. The questions we bring to the text will yield multiple answers, sometimes mutually exclusive, and sometimes complementary and even mutually enhancing. We do not ask only, what did this text mean in its original context, the time that the author of Genesis wrote the tale? Nor do we ask only, what does Genesis 18 mean in a Christian context, with Jesus? Nor again do we focus only on the various readings of the ancient scripture in the post-biblical Jewish context, without Jesus. Rather, we seek to put these various interpretations into dialogue, for such dialogue helps us understand why, when we read the same text or look at the same painting, we come away with such different views. The better we can see through the eyes of our neighbors, the better able we are to be good neighbors. The more aware we are of the historical settings of the original texts, as best as we can determine them, the better we can see how the texts might have been interpreted by the ancient audience that first heard them. And the more aware we are of the historical settings of those who interpreted the biblical texts, the better we understand our own religious traditions and those of our neighbors. This multi-lensed perspective comes from our teaching experience. In both our classrooms and our various programs in churches and synagogues, we have encountered individuals with limited views of their own traditions and even more limited views of interpretations in other religious communities. we have seen not only ignorance, but antipathy toward the views of their neighbors. We have met many Christians who wonder about the value of the Old Testament, which they see as proclaiming an Old Testament God of wrath versus the New Testament God of love, or which they conclude is about law, seen as a negative, rather than about grace, seen as epitomizing the positive. And we have frequently encountered Jewish audiences who find the New Testament irrelevant at best, or a co-optation and even deformation of the Tanakh written by Jews for Jews. Both of these attitudes are unfortunate. Ignorance of the other's tradition is not bliss. We live in a multicultural society where we cannot afford to ignore the perspective of others, or indeed to perceive them as other. We have thus teamed up as a scholar who predominantly studies the Hebrew Bible / Old Testament / Tanakh, Brettler, and one who predominantly studies the New Testament, Levine, and who each works in reception history, the interpretation of these texts by the communities that hold them sacred, to examine 10 well-known passages or themes from Israel's scriptures that are important to the New Testament. Each of our central chapters asks 3 questions. What did the text mean in its original context in ancient Israel? How did the New Testament authors interpret that text? And how do post-biblical Jews from the time of Jesus, for example, the Dead Sea Scrolls, the first-century historian Josephus, and the first-century philosopher Philo, through the rabbinic and medieval Jewish tradition, and later Christian traditions, understand those same texts? Our chapters highlight how differently different communities interpret the same material. For example, for Jews, the Book of Jonah is predominantly about the power of repentance, and the post-biblical tradition also finds in the brief book a great amount of humor. Meanwhile, for Christians, it is a book predominantly about the resurrection of Jesus on the third day, and there is nothing funny about that. In other cases, a particular theme or text is important to one community and relatively unimportant to another. For example, Isaiah's depictions of the servant of the Lord, sometimes called the suffering servant, are central to Christianity, as already reflected in the New Testament, but most Jews are unaware of this image. Indeed, a number of verses that have enormous import for the New Testament and ongoing Christian theology have become virtually unknown to Jewish readers, just as Jewish interpretations, and there are usually multiple interpretations of the same verse or passage, are generally unknown to Christians. Thus, this book is, in part, an act of recovery so that we can all be more familiar with biblical passages that Jews and Christians share, albeit with different emphases. As biblical scholars, we believe that we have an obligation to provide careful explications of these texts and interpretations in a sympathetic light. Our agenda is not to show how one reading is right and another reading is wrong. It is rather to show how these interpretations developed, how they make sense given the theological presuppositions of their authors and original audiences, and how they are necessarily partial. We also seek to demonstrate how translation matters, how reading the original Hebrew, the pre-Christian Greek translation, the Septuagint, and different English versions creates substantially different impressions. Translators, sometimes deliberately and often unconsciously, choose readings that fit the needs of their own religious communities. For example, in examining the Bible's very first story, we explain how Genesis 1-2 can be seen as speaking of both a mighty wind and the Spirit of God hovering over the deep. We see how Isaiah 7 could be speaking of a pregnant young woman, a soon-to-be-pregnant, by usual means, young woman, or a virgin who is also pregnant. Finally, acknowledging the polemical implications of some of the Jewish and Christian interpretations, we ask of each text or theme, what might we say about them today, given our knowledge of history and theology, and given our commitment to and respect for differing traditions? With this approach, we then show how polemic can be turned to possibility. We have worked together before in editing both the first, 2011, and second, 2017, editions of the Jewish Annotated New Testament, a volume that frequently flags how the followers of Jesus recontextualized and reinterpreted earlier Jewish texts. In each case, we wished we had more pages to develop these readings. We are therefore grateful for the opportunity to collaborate on this volume. In both editing the Jewish Annotated and especially in writing this book, we learned to work together, to sharpen our arguments, to discover how the two of us saw different aspects of the same text. We experienced firsthand how the type of paired study, Hebrew chevruta, that is the hallmark of traditional Jewish learning, leads to effective understanding, clarity, and sharpness, and we are both grateful for the experience of having sometimes sparred over, but mostly marveled over, even laughed over, almost every interpretation, every word in the following pages. A note on translations and abbreviations. Biblical translations in this book come from the New Revised Standard Version, NRSV, of the Bible, unless otherwise noted. We also use the New Jewish Publication Society Tanakh Translation of the Hebrew Bible, NJPS, completed in 1985 and last revised in 1999. We recommend this study edition, which includes brief commentary and essays cited in this book. Adele Berlin and Marc V. Brettler, editors, The Jewish Study Bible, 2nd edition, Oxford, Oxford University Press, 2014. At times we quote from the Septuagint, the ancient Jewish-Greek translation of the Hebrew Bible. For translation, we cite the NETS, Albert Petersma and Benjamin G. Wright, editors, A New English Translation of the Septuagint, Oxford, Oxford University Press, 2007. Each of these translations is available online and will often be referenced in the book by these abbreviations. Other abbreviations. ANF, The Ante-Nicene Fathers, 10 volumes. DDD, Dictionary of Deities and Demons in the Bible, 2nd Revised Edition. EBR, Encyclopedia of the Bible and Its Reception. EDEJ, The Erdman's Dictionary of Early Judaism. EDSS, Encyclopedia of the Dead Sea Scrolls, 2 volumes. HEB, this marks cases where the Hebrew chapter and verse numbers differ from those in the NRSV. JANT, The Jewish Annotated New Testament, New Revised Standard Version, 2nd Edition. JSB, The Jewish Study Bible, Jewish Publication Society Tanakh Translation, 2nd Edition. KJV, King James Version. LXX, Septuagint. MT, Masoretic Text. OTB, Outside the Bible, Ancient Jewish Writings Related to Scripture. TDOT, Theological Dictionary of the Old Testament, John T. Willis et al. Translators, 8 volumes. For Hebrew and Greek, we use a popular phonetic transliteration. Our aim is to make the original languages more available to the readers rather than to provide full consistency. Chapter 1, On Bibles and Their Interpreters. Same stories, different Bibles. The Bible, in the singular, does not exist. Different communities have different Bibles. We don't mean that they prefer different translations, but that they have Bibles comprised of different books, in different orders, in different languages. The biggest difference is between the Jewish and Christian communities, for only Christians have a New Testament. In fact, only Christians have an Old Testament, which itself differs among the various Christian communions. Jews have the Tanakh. And although the Old Testament and Tanakh share books, the communities interpret the shared verses differently. The Old Testament and the Tanakh are not, today for Christians and Jews, self-standing books. Christians read their Old Testament through the lens of the New Testament, and Jews read the Tanakh through the lens of post-biblical Jewish commentaries. These differences raise major interpretive questions. For example, who is the Bible's main character? Is it God? Is it Jesus? Does it lack a main character? What is its main point, or is there one? Does the original meaning of a passage, apart from Christian or later Jewish interpretation?
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.